In the early days of World War II, most soldiers still used bolt-action rifles that required each shot to be loaded and fired manually. But in 1941, the US Army introduced the revolutionary M1 Garand rifle. It could fire 8 shots as quickly as a soldier could pull the trigger. General George S. Patton said, "The M1 rifle is the greatest battle implement ever devised."
I'm Nick Kaikkonen, owner of Vulcan Gun Refinishing. We restore World War II weapons.
Business is brisk. Nick has up to 60 jobs at a time in the shop. And the M1 Garand is the gun he sees the most. Canadian-born John C. Garand spent 15 years creating this revolutionary rifle for the US Army. It ejected the spent bullet casing and loaded a new round, unassisted by the shooter.
It made a huge difference because firepower is what won the war. It's the amount of lead you can throw at the other guy that's going to win a battle. So the Garand outshone everybody else.
Nick's task is to return the weapon to its former glory. He does what every soldier learned to do. He takes it apart. GIs could field strip an M1 in less than a minute, but Nick's taking his time with a detail strip. The M1 was unveiled in 1937 and put into mass production in 1940. 80% of its components were factory produced on site at the Springfield Armory, many with machines created just for this rifle. Nick is looking for anything worn or defective.
A lot of parts have a very small window where they're going to work or they're not going to work.
Defective parts are either repaired or replaced. Then it's time to clean the wood. Stocks are stripped of any finish, then washed and boiled to remove any grease and oil. The M1's steel parts need to be degreased. That starts with a half-hour bath in mineral spirits. Then they're scrubbed to remove debris that has been caked on for decades. Sandblasting scours away any remaining dirt and exposes deep rust pits. That kind of damage is repaired off-site. Sandblasting also beats up the item just a little bit. Roughing up the surface helps the next step. It's a hot bath in manganese phosphate, a process called parkerizing, which prevents corrosion.
So when you put oil on it for the very first time after it's parkerized, the oil will drip down and seep into all the little cracks and crevices, giving it an outstanding corrosion coat.
The metal is then rinsed to neutralize the solution and stop the reaction. The parts are then dried and oiled. This both protects the parts and helps the weapon to operate smoothly. The metal needs a lot of care. The Garands weren't made with the best steel, and with extreme usage, harsh conditions, and a lack of proper maintenance, they wouldn't last.
Life expectancy of a Jeep was 90 days in World War II. So what was the life expectancy of a shoulder-fired weapon, like a Garand or any other rifle? Could only be a few weeks, maybe a couple of months at most.
The wood parts, now dried for several days, get some attention.
Boiling expands the wood, so if there's any cracks that are very superficial initially, now they'll show up quite readily.
Nick repairs any dings with a little filler. Finally, Nick protects the wood with tung oil.
The US Army switched to tung oil in about 43. They used to use linseed oil, but they found that linseed oil would never quite get dry, and especially after a heavy firefight where they might have fired hundreds or even thousands of rounds, that gun gets so hot that linseed oil gets soft and almost runny again. So any dirt and dust will stick right to that gun and create a mess. So they realized that tung oil was much better because tung oil would dry overnight and nothing would stick to it. And even when it's heated back up, it'll still stay nice and dry.
It's time to put this legendary weapon back together. Old damaged pieces become a pristine piece of history once again. Nick prepares the trigger group. It was designed to be removed and replaced in one piece, a special feature found on the M1. The trigger group also locks with other components inside the stock to tighten and secure the gun. What once was rusty steel and moldy wood is now a proud representative of its glorious past. Now, the M1 needs to be fired. It's an important final step.
If it's not put together properly, that gun could kill people. It's possible. So we have to be very diligent in our work.
This serious weapon has a peculiar tick. As the last round is fired, the clip holding it ejects, hitting some metal on the way out. Legend has it that Nazi soldiers learned to listen for the telltale ping, knowing that the Americans' guns needed reloading. American GIs quickly countered, knocking empty clips against something metal to fool the Germans into advancing. The M1 Garand was so reliable, it was used through the Korean and Vietnam Wars.
If it's in rough shape when it comes in and when we're done, it looks new again, it functions like new, that's a good feeling. It just keeps me motivated every day to do this.
Baseball and football are loved in America, despite being as different as their central piece of equipment, the ball. Football is a game so violent, it was forced to change rules in the early 20th century. And the ball changed with it. Baseball is a game so relaxed that in its early days, the ball was not standardized and was often made by the pitcher.
My name is Paul Cunningham. I am the founder and craftsman at Leatherhead Sports.
Baseball is baked into Paul's DNA. He was born in Cooperstown, New York, the home of the Baseball Hall of Fame, where he eventually worked.
Part of my job with the Hall of Fame was recreating historic baseball games. And in the process of recreating these games, we used a historic baseball. It's a lemon peel style baseball.
The lemon peel design is pressed onto a piece of leather with a knife sharp template. It includes all the holes for stitching, which is done by Paul's employee, Debbie. For a center, they use a cloth-covered rubber ball. Early baseball centers could be a bunch of rags or string wrapped around a sturgeon eye. The circumference varied by as much as 1.5 inches.
Because there was no standardization, I consider the balls that I make to be very authentic in the fact that I am replicating the historic stitch pattern.
But the lemon peel ball was short-lived.
Baseball as a sport really evolved. I mean, it wasn't invented.
In the 1870s, a retired pitcher named A.G. Spaulding convinced the National League to adopt the figure-eight ball he had been making. It was named after the two identical pieces of leather cut in a figure-eight, which nestled together and could be united in one long stitch. The standardized ball revolutionized pitching. Raised stitches work against the air, making the ball curve if thrown in a certain way. Since the ball was always the same, the pitches could be practiced and perfected. The figure-eight pattern is still used today. And just like in the old days, every Major League Baseball is hand-stitched.